Distinguished future physicians, welcome to Stomp on Step 1, the only free video series that helps you study more efficiently by focusing on the highest yield material. I'm Brian McDaniel, and I will be your guide on this journey through mood disorders. This is the first video in my playlist that covers everything you need to know in psychiatry for the USMLE Step 1 Medical Board exam. In this video, we're going to review mood disorders like depression, bipolar, cyclothymia, adjustment disorder, and dysthymia. Mood disorders, which are also known as affective disorder, are a collection of psychiatric conditions that involve a pervasive distortion of one's emotional state or affect. This should not be confused with normal fluctuations in mood. Everyone has periodic, mild changes in their affect as a result of their circumstances. Mood disorders are more extreme changes in mood that are often unrelated to an individual's circumstances. However, mood disorders are characterized by periods of normal or near-normal affect and function in between more severe mood episodes. Euthymia can be thought of as neutral or normal mood. This is when a person isn't particularly happy or sad. Psychiatrically healthy individuals spend much of their time in a euthymic state. But a normal patient will have times when they feel happy or sad. In certain circumstances, a healthy individual may even have transient feelings of elation or mild depression. For example, if a person has a really stressful work situation or they win the lottery, it would be normal for them to have big changes in their mood. However, these emotions do not lead to a loss of function and do not persist. Changes in affect become pathologic when extreme emotions are felt. These feelings persist, and a loss of function is involved. Mood can be thought of as a continuum ranging from extremely happy, mania with psychosis, to extremely sad, depression with psychosis, or suicide. Mood disorders can primarily be differentiated based on where they lie on this continuum. And I think being able to look at the continuum as a picture helps simplify things a lot. So here's what we are going to be working towards during this video. I'm sure this is a bit intimidating to look at, but don't worry, we're going to break it down piece by piece and make it really simple. If you want a high resolution version of this picture for your notes or because the video looks a little bit fuzzy on your screen, you can click on the orange button here to be taken to my website where that is available. As you can see, the middle of the mood continuum is euthymia or neutral mood. Then, as you move in either direction, you get more extreme moods. On the right, we have happy affect, and to the left, we have sad affect. Healthy individuals will spend most of their time in the state of euthymia, but they will occasionally fluctuate from being sad to happy. So this is our range of normal moods. Way out to the right, we have extremely happy mood, which is mania with psychosis. And way out to the left, we have depression with suicidal ideation or psychosis. Extremes of the continuum have a loss of function where the individual's ability to function at home and at work or school are inhibited. As we move forward, we will plot each mood disorder on this same picture. Depression can involve a loss of interest in previously pleasurable activities, aka anhedonia, low self-esteem, hopelessness, and fatigue. Depressed individuals may sleep way more or way less than normal, have decreased libido, eat way more or way less than normal, or have a decreased ability to concentrate. Moderate to severe cases can cause a loss of function. In severe cases, depression can lead to suicidal ideation or psychosis. Psychosis is going to involve things like delusions and hallucinations, but we're going to save that topic for the next video in the series. Usually when somebody says a person has depression, what they really mean is that person has major depressive disorder and that they don't want to waste all those extra syllables. So major depressive disorder gets shortened to depression. But you need to recognize that depression is an emotion and MDD is a medical diagnosis with specific criteria. You can see here in the top right corner, I give major depressive disorder and suicide a high yield rating of 9. The high yield rating is a scale from 0 to 10 that gives you an estimate for how important each topic is for the Step 1 exam, based on a number of factors that include how often the topic appears in retired Step 1 questions. Major depressive disorder, MDD, is a depressive disorder with very specific DSM criteria. These criteria involve a certain number of symptoms over a specific time period, but these details are beyond the scope of the USMLE Step 1 Medical Board exam, so I will not cover them here. All you need to know is that MDD involves having multiple moderate to severe depressive symptoms, more often than not, for at least a couple weeks. We will cover treatment options for MDD in a later video. So for MDD, the patient will experience everything to the left-hand side on our mood continuum. They may occasionally be euthymic, but more often than not, they are going to have moderate to severe depressive symptoms. Suicide is most often associated with major depressive disorder, but it can also be the result of borderline personality disorder, psychosis, substance abuse, or other psychiatric illnesses that have a depressive component, like bipolar disorder or adjustment disorder. Suicidal ideation is when a patient frequently has thoughts of wanting to kill themselves, but has not actually attempted suicide yet. You need to ask every patient with psychiatric symptoms about suicidal ideation at every visit. If the patient has the intent to commit suicide and a plan for doing so, they need to be hospitalized. In some cases, a patient like this might need to be Baker-acted against their will. If a patient has thoughts of suicide but has no plan, they can be treated as an outpatient. Recognizing depressive symptoms is pretty easy. However, making a diagnosis of MDD is a bit tougher because there's a long differential diagnosis for depression. In order to receive a diagnosis of MDD, the patient's symptoms cannot be better explained by another medical condition or substance, such as medications or street drugs. For example, the abuse of things like alcohol or benzos can cause depressive symptoms. Alternatively, withdrawal from stimulants like cocaine can cause depressive symptoms. There are also numerous general medical conditions that need to be considered. Hypothyroidism and anemia can frequently present with depressive symptoms, but they will usually give you clues that clearly point towards those diagnoses in the question stem. For example, pale skin or laboratory results in anemia, and cold intolerance or skin changes in hypothyroidism. There are also numerous psychiatric illnesses that can present with depressive symptoms. On the exam, you have to keep an eye out for clues that make one diagnosis more likely than another. Often the severity, duration of symptoms, and the presence or absence of acute stressors are the most important factors to consider. So keep that in mind as we move forward. Dysthymia is a milder, prolonged version of MDD. These patients have depressive symptoms for more than 2 years, but they are not severe enough to cause a loss of function or suicidal ideation. On our continuum, dysthymia would be in this range. Adjustment disorder is sometimes referred to as situational depression. It is a lack of the ability to adjust to an acute stressor that leads to depressive symptoms that are out of proportion to the situation. These symptoms can be severe enough to lead to a loss of function and suicide. Examples of acute stressors would include marital problems, moving to a new city, being diagnosed with a fatal disease, or getting fired. So you can think of adjustment disorder as MDD that is caused by a situation. This disorder usually resolves when the stressor is removed, or resolves spontaneously over a few month period as the person is able to adapt to the new situation. On our continuum, adjustment disorder would cover the same range as MDD. Normal bereavement is a normal response to severe stressor or personal tragedy. This most often involves grief following the loss of a loved one. The patients have mild to moderate depressive symptoms, but can have short periods of euthymia or even happiness during their depressive episode. In question stems, this will often be described as having symptoms wax and wane. Patients' mood should slowly improve over time, and the depressive symptoms should largely resolve over the course of a year. Normal bereavement should not be debilitating, and the patient should be able to function at home, work, and school. These patients usually do not require pharmacologic treatment. Pathologic grief is either prolonged, lasting more than a year, or more extreme, with a loss of function or suicide. On our continuum, normal bereavement would cover this range of emotions, while Pathologic bereavement would be a bit more extreme and cover a bit more of the area on our table. Postpartum depressive symptoms are a range of mood disorders seen in obstetric patients after delivery. Postpartum blues is a common mild form of depression that usually resolves spontaneously within a couple weeks. Postpartum depression is more severe and lasts more than a couple weeks. It can lead to a loss of function and ambivalence towards the child. To prevent neglect of the child, you should make sure somebody else can help care for the child, and the mother is usually treated with SSRIs. Postpartum psychosis is a rare disorder where the mother actively wants to harm the infant because she thinks the child is evil. The mother requires inpatient treatment and will usually be treated with antipsychotics. Mania is a period of extremely elevated mood, aka euphoria, and excessive energy despite a lack of sleep. Manic individuals have rapid speech and talk more often than they normally do. They often have difficulty concentrating and are easily distracted. Mania may be accompanied by disinhibition and risky or inappropriate behavior. It can involve irritability and delusions of grandeur, or a belief that they are famous, influential, powerful, or a genius. Severe mania is sometimes accompanied by psychosis. Manic patients have an almost complete loss of function and require hospitalization. Hypomania is a milder version of mania that usually does not require hospitalization. Hypomania has less of an impact on function than mania, and in some cases, hypomania can actually increase productivity. Type 1 bipolar disorder is alternating periods of mania and moderate to severe depression, followed by a return to normal functioning. However, the presence of a depressive phase is not required for a diagnosis to be made. A single episode of mania is enough for a diagnosis even before the inevitable depressive phase arises. This disease was formerly referred to as manic depression because it has alternating periods of mania and depression. We will discuss treatment options in a later video. It is beyond the scope of the exam, but there are actually two types of bipolar disease. Type 1 is the classic presentation, which covers the full range of moods from severe depression to severe mania. Type 2 can have severe depression, but only has hypomania and not full-blown mania. Cyclothymia is a related disorder that fluctuates between mild depression and hypomania, so it would only cover this portion of the continuum. Schizoaffective disorder is a disease that has characteristics of bipolar disorder and schizophrenia, but I'm going to cover that disease in my next video covering psychotic disorders because I feel like it fits a bit better there. To see the next video in the series that will cover schizophrenia and psychotic disorders, please click this black box here. But I want to take this opportunity to thank you all. Stomp on Step 1 has recently reached some big milestones. We now have well over 100,000 views and almost 2,000 subscribers. That is all due to you, the viewers, watching videos, sharing it with friends, subscribing, and giving feedback. We have even started to get some donations recently, which is helping us cover some of the cost of the project. We would have not been able to get this far without all of your support, so thank you.